Thank you, Elaine. Elaine is a great president. We're grateful to have her. And, you know, I'm honored that I was asked to introduce our speaker because many of my clients and future clients are actually here that I get to perform and speak for in the direct selling network marketing industry. But what's so amazing about this guy I'm going to introduce today is that I got his DVD a couple months ago, and it went in my stash of other DVDs from other speakers that seems to never end. And I thought, well, I'm gonna listen to it or watch it whenever I get a chance. And I finally found myself driving between Idaho and Oregon in a 5-day road trip. And I said, this is the right time to listen to Todd.
Thank you.
And I put on this, I'm looking at it as I'm driving, and it's this picture of this young guy. And I thought, oh, right, like he has anything important to say, whatever. And I put it in, and I flipped the DVD player down behind my head, because that's where it sits in my car. And as I'm listening to the DVD over the first 2 or 3 minutes, I thought, this is actually good. Because most of them aren't, you know, that you get, the DVDs, the books, the things that you read and listen to. And I'm driving and I'm like, where's my notepad? And so I'm reaching back there trying to find my notepad because you're not supposed to text or anything on your phone. So I was just going to write in a book. So now I'm writing as I'm driving, and I'm looking back to see on his flip chart on this DVD. And I finally listened to the entire thing, and I said, I have to watch that now. It was mind-blowing. And I don't say that lightly because I don't endorse very many people as speakers or very many people as entertainers. But this guy, I do. He is unbelievable with what he taught me. I thought I could help him maybe with his career. I can't help him. He's unbelievable. He helped me in just that moment. And today he's here to help you. He's built in the network marketing industry an annual revenue of $20 million. And that's not an easy thing to do. He did that in his 20s. Today he's going to impart to you how you can help others understand the mastery of storytelling. It's an art, and he is a master of it. So please welcome a man who has spoken all over the world. This is Ty Bennett.
Thank you very much. Thank you. Appreciate it. So how many of you recognize the name Howard Schultz? Does anybody recognize that name? A few of you. Okay, let me tell you a little bit about Howard Schultz. Howard was born in the housing projects of Brooklyn, New York. But unlike so many people who are born into that situation, he actually found his way out of the projects. And for him, his ticket was a full-ride football scholarship to the University of Northern Michigan. And Howard loved to play football. He played for 4 years, but more importantly, that scholarship allowed him to get a college education. He actually became the very first member of his family to get a college education. And after college, he held several different jobs until he became the sales director for a Swedish housewares company called Hammerplast. And it was at Hammerplast that he started selling these Swedish drip coffee makers to this little coffee house in Seattle. They bought tons of them. They were his number one client. And so he decided to go and visit this client in Seattle. That client, that one coffee house, was called Starbucks. Now, if you haven't put it together, Howard Schultz today is the chairman and CEO of Starbucks. So let me tell you how that happened. Howard flew over to Seattle, and I don't know if this has ever happened to you, but from the moment he walked off the plane, he fell in love. He loved everything about the city. He had never been there before, and he walked into Starbucks, and he was amazed at the ambiance they had created. He loved the care that the owners took in choosing and roasting the beans, and he left that day and said, I'm going to be part of that company. Now, it took him an entire year to convince the owners of Starbucks to hire him. And they finally did. They brought him on as the sales director. And as the sales director, they sent him over to Italy to do some work. And while he was in Italy, he was walking around. And he started to look around and he thought, this is crazy. He said, there are literally coffee houses on every corner. And at first he thought, there's nobody that can drink this much coffee. I mean, there's no way this could be the case. And then he had this epiphany. He realized that the coffee houses were more than that. They were kind of part of the societal glue of Italy, if you will. They were a place to have a relaxing afternoon, to meet a friend. They were a home away from home. They were an office away from your office. You could go and you could read a newspaper. You could have a business meeting. And he came back and he said, I've got it. We can take this one coffee house, we can expand it, we can grow it all around the world. And the owners of Starbucks said, thank you, but no thank you. They said, we're happy, we're profitable, we're good, we don't want to expand. And so Howard made a choice. He left and he went literally down the road and he started his own coffee house called Giornali. And it was so successful that he came back a year later and he bought Starbucks for $3.8 million. And the rest, as they say, is history, right? Today, Howard is the chairman and CEO of Starbucks. He's one of the richest men in the world. Starbucks has grown to 16,000 plus locations in 53 markets around the world. And you know, Starbucks is interesting. It's one of those iconic companies that personifies an industry, right? I mean, we actually use the word Starbucks as a noun. We don't say, I'm gonna go get a cup of coffee. We say, I'm gonna go and get a Starbucks, right? I don't even drink coffee and I think about Starbucks when I think about coffee. And I don't think it's just because they make the best cup of coffee. I think there's more to it. You see, Starbucks is constantly given awards. They're constantly praised for their friendly customer service. And I think it has a lot to do with the way that Howard runs that company. He has this one little phrase. It's this tiny little phrase that has a ton of power in it. He's always saying, we're not in the coffee business serving people. We're in the people business serving coffee. Now think about that for you, because the truth is all of us in here, we're in the people business, aren't we? We all interact with people every single day at work, at home, at play. We're in the people business. Now that story is how I start my keynote on my book, The Power of Influence. What do stories do? Why are they so powerful? Why is it that you as speakers need to become master storytellers? What is it that stories do for your audience? Yeah.
It makes them reflect on things they know and connect with you.
Okay, so it makes them reflect on things they know and connect with you. Absolutely. Your job as a speaker is not just to impart wisdom, it's to cause them to step back and say, how does this apply to me? To actually reflect and apply it. What else do stories do? Yeah. They generate emotion. That's a key thing. We're going to come back to that in just a second. What else do stories do? Why are they so powerful? Yeah, over here. They entertain. Sometimes stories are just for simple entertainment purposes, and that's a great thing. That's something that every speaker should be entertaining. Doesn't mean you have to be hysterical like Jason. It means you need to be able to captivate them. You need to be entertaining in some way. What else do stories do? Yeah, back here. Perfect. Okay, think about it. Our minds are genetically programmed to attach meaning to a message, right? When we hear a story, the storytelling was the very first form of communication. And so our minds have learned to figure out what's the meaning of a story. I mean, think about any story, like The Boy Who Cried Wolf. What's the meaning of that story? Don't lie, right? Tell the truth, otherwise it's going to get you in trouble. What about The Ugly Duckling? Right? It's about being yourself. It's about being true to who you are. We can always remember the meaning of it, and it increases the memory of it. They hold on to a story much better than just a simple fact. Now, you mentioned before that it creates emotion. Now, here's my point. What do people buy on? What do people act on? What do people remember and implement into their life? Without emotion, people don't take action. And our job is to increase motivation. If you want to share a point, if you want to sell a product, if you want to impart some idea, some strategy, cast a vision for your people, you need to engage them emotionally so that they will take action on that and start to move forward. A story is an incredible way to do that. It engages the emotion in the people that are listening to you, if we can tell the story the right way. Now, how many of you have ever felt like you were failing? Have you ever had that feeling? Is that not the worst feeling in the entire world? That is the worst feeling ever. Now, when I was 21 years old, I started a business with my brother Scott in direct sales. And about 10 months into that business, I got married to my wife Sarah. I was 21, we were young, we were both college students. And we got married in August. We moved into this little one-bedroom apartment. We were both in school full-time, and I was building our business on a part-time basis. That was the only means of support that we had. And as we were building this business, I felt like I was putting in a very full-time effort, although I was doing it very part-time. And the month we got married for me was a huge wake-up call. And the reason being is because Sarah and I got married, we went on our honeymoon. We came back. We got all settled in this little apartment. We had our normal cost of living, like food and insurance and books and all the things that went along with school. And the rent in that one-bedroom apartment was $600. My wake-up call came when my check came for the month. It was $800. And my brother and I were partners, so I gave him his $400. And I had to explain to my brand-new bride 2 days off her honeymoon that, hey, guess what I made? $400. And I felt horrible. And for me, it was the first time I had to be accountable. Have you ever had that experience before? I mean, I didn't have to account to anybody before. I was single. I just figured it out. And I dreaded this conversation. I just did not want to tell her, look at what I did. I made $400. I was just dreading having this conversation. So I remember I sat down with her and I said, Sarah, we only made $400. And she had the normal reaction of, well, is this going to work? Are we going to be okay? I mean, is everything going to be all right? And we had this long conversation. And then in her wisdom, she asked me two questions that completely changed my life. The first thing she said, okay, forget where you are. Just forget about everything. Forget about the $400. Just if you were to look at this with fresh eyes, do you still believe in this business? Do you believe it can take you where you want to go? And I said, yeah, I do. I really do. I believe in it. And then she asked me probably the best question I've ever been asked in my life. She said, then to get from where you are now to where you want to go, what needs to change? That's a great question to ask ourselves often. And you know, I don't know if you react this way, but my first reaction is I wanted to change everything else around me. I wanted to change the products. I wanted to change the people's reactions. I wanted to change everything but me. And the truth is the only thing that really needed to change was who? It was me. I needed to change. The thing is, I was talking to people. I just wasn't influential. I wasn't moving anybody. Nobody was buying my products. Nobody was following my ideas. Nobody was willing to follow me. I needed to learn how to tell my story in a way that caused them to listen, to pay attention, and actually take action. And so I made a decision that day. I was going to pursue the study and the understanding of how I could perfect my communication, my storytelling. I was going to pursue that better than I had pursued anything in my life. I needed to change. I needed to become more influential, otherwise it wasn't going to work. And so I did. I started to read books like crazy. I wouldn't just read them, I would study them, and I would take what I learned and I would apply it. I started to go to seminars. I started to go to listen to the best speakers, the best salespeople, anybody I could get in front of, anybody I could see, and I would analyze it. I recorded every conversation, every presentation. If I was in front of a group, I videotaped myself. I would go back and analyze it. That is shocking when you are horrible. It is a bad experience the first time you do that. And I just started to practice that as much as I could so that I could better my communication. I learned how to tell my story in a way that caused people to listen. And it caused people to follow. And we took that business from where I couldn't even pay the rent in my little one-bedroom apartment to building it to over $20 million in annual revenue while still in my 20s. And it's all because of this skill set that I want to dive into with you. Because ultimately, master storytellers, whether you're involved in speaking, selling, leading, teaching, it doesn't matter. If you can learn how to tell a story that moves somebody, you can be influential. That's what we're going to talk about today. Now, how many of you have ever read the book, The 7 Habits of Highly Effective People? Virtually every hand in here. Lots of times audiences are like, huh? But this group's good. This group has all read it. This book, this copy was given to me by my parents when I was 14 years old. It's pretty beat up. Amazing book, written by Stephen Covey. He just lived down the road from here, not too far, passed away a few months ago. Just an icon in this industry. This book is an incredible book. It was voted as the number one business book of the 21st century. Well, the first time I ever had a chance to meet Dr. Stephen Covey was at his home. It was an event that he was hosting, and a mutual friend introduced me to Dr. Covey by saying, Stephen, this is Ty Bennett. He's writing a book. And Stephen said, Ty, I'm glad you're here, and welcomed me. And then he said, what's the title of your book? I said, it's called The Power of Influence, which all of you have a copy of right there, and I hope you enjoy it. Stephen said, I like that. Can I give you some advice? Now, I was a hopeful author at the time. I hadn't written a book, and his book had sold about 30 million copies, so I said, absolutely, I'd love your advice. This is what he said. He said, make sure you write the book for the reader and not the writer. I said, what do you mean by that? He said, a book that's written for the writer to build themselves up for their own ego, it's going to fall flat. He said, but a book that's written for the reader to teach, to inspire, to change people, that book will be an instant home run. And then he kept going. He said, you know, it's interesting, at my age, at the time he was probably in his late 70s, he said, at my age, it's funny because you go through life thinking that life is about achievement. What can I get? What's the next step I need to take? What's the next ladder I need to climb? He said, what you realize when you get older is that life isn't about achievement, it's about contribution. It's about what can I give? It's about how can I help people? It's about how can I serve? It's about what can I do for those that I'm working with, those that I'm teaching, those that I'm leading, those that I'm speaking to. And what Stephen Covey was talking about when it pertained to a book is he was talking about the mindset of an influencer. What I want to do is I want to walk through the mindset, the skill set, and then the tool set of storytelling. Okay, so let's start with the mindset, because if your mind is right, you're going to be effective. Now, ultimately, what do I mean by that? Well, your focus as an influencer is always on your audience. Now, what Stephen Covey was saying is write the book for them. They're your audience. What I'm saying as a speaker is speak for them. They're your audience. As a salesperson, it's about your client. As a teacher, it's about your students. It's never about you. Think about it. As a leader, if you don't have followers, are you a leader? No, you don't exist. As an influencer, if no one is being influenced by you, then you don't exist without them. And so we screw it up so often because we think it's all about us. And it's really all about them. It doesn't matter if your audience is one or 1,000. Your focus is on the audience. Now, our purpose then is to engage that audience. What does it mean to engage? What does that word mean? Engagement. Thoughts? What does engagement mean?
Give and take.
Give and take. Perfect. What else?
Encompass. Grab a hold
to encompass. To make them part of it? Absolutely. If you're going to engage an audience, you're going to grab them, hold, make them part so they're participating, so they're hanging on the edge of their seats. I mean, think about it. As a speaker, most speakers bore their audiences. That's just a fact. Most speakers would say, okay, you tell them what you're going to tell them, and then you tell them, and then you tell them what you told them. So you tell them how you're going to bore them, and then you bore them, and then you tell them how you bored them. And they aren't paying attention to any of it. What you want to do is you want to engage them. You need to make them part. They need to feel like, man, I cannot wait for the next thing that they're going to say. So how do we do that? Well, there's lots of tools of engagement. There's lots of ways we do that. Humor is a great tool. Shock is a great tool. Entertainment's a great tool. But stories are one of the greatest tools that you and I have. Because stories automatically draw people in. Again, our minds are just attracted to them. Now, when I speak to direct sales audiences, I always tell them that we need to stop giving sales presentations and we need to start having sales conversations. Think about it. A presentation, by definition, is a monologue. It's one person talking. And nobody likes to be talked at, do they? They like to be talked with. A conversation, by definition, is a dialogue. It's a back and forth. There's exchange. There's two people involved. And you can do that even with a huge audience. I'll teach you how to do that. You can feel like it's a conversation. Because what you want, even if you're speaking to 15,000 people, is you want people to leave and say something like, just felt like he was talking just to me. Man, that was exactly what I needed to hear. That was incredible how he spoke right to what I needed. That's the kind of feedback we want as speakers, isn't it? That's what we want to hear our audience say because they feel like they're involved, they're engaged in what we're doing. You know, not too long ago at the National Speakers Association, I was at the annual conference, I was walking around and I was meeting people. Who's been to the National Speakers Association annual conference? Okay, you go around and you meet all these speakers, and the typical conversation as you meet somebody is they say, so what do you speak about, right? That's the commonality that we all share. So what's your topic? What do you speak on? And I remember I met this one lady, and she said, what do you speak on? I said, I speak on influence to sales and leadership organizations. And she said, so are you a sales speaker or a leadership speaker? And I said, well, I'm both. And she goes, you can't be both. And I said, well, then I'm screwed, because that's what I am. I don't know. And the reason I tell that story is because I think sales and leadership and influence has changed. Think about it. In our world today, push strategies, arm twisting, all those things don't work. Maybe they never did. But sales today is about influence. It's about attracting people to you. And as speakers, some people would say, well, I'm not in sales. And I hate to break it to you, but you are. Everybody in here is. You're either selling a product, an idea, a strategy, a vision, yourself, whatever it may be. We are all in sales, and I think we would do better to embrace that fact and actually get good at it. I think that would help us out. And if we do that and we start to learn how to influence people, they're attracted to us. There's a great sales trainer by the name of Lisa Sasevich, and I love what she said here. She said, in today's world, people are looking to be inspired, encouraged, taught, heard. It's no longer about simply selling, it's about becoming a trusted advisor. I love that. You're now learning to influence, and that, my friends, is where you begin to make the biggest impact and attract dedicated, highly committed, highly invested clients and contributors. That's what we want, right? We need to become influential in the way that we speak. We need to learn how to captivate an audience, how to bring them in, and we need to learn how to engage them. Because without engagement, there is never any influence. You're not going to influence somebody who is not paying attention. You're not going to influence somebody who's not getting the whole depth of your message. So what does that engagement hang on? There's a balance that each of us needs to create. And the balance is between credibility on one side and relatability on the other side. Credibility on one side, relatability on the other side. And I would write this down. If your audience doesn't view you as credible, they will not care about your message. Think about it. If they don't see you as somebody that they should listen to, that you have something that they need, that they can buy into you, that you're going to take them somewhere where that they've never been, if they don't see that credibility in you, they will not care about what you have to say. But on the other side, we have to be relatable. We have to be able to relate, because if your audience doesn't view you as relatable, they won't respond. They're never going to take action. If you are separated from them, if they look at you and say, well, he's the anomaly, she's the anomaly, I could never do that, then there's a disconnect that happens. And remember this phrase, your purpose is not perfection. It is connection with your audience. Think about it. How many people in here have ever given a perfect speech? Everything just went perfect. No ums, no stutters, no flaws. Nothing was wrong. It's never happened before. It's never, ever going to go perfect. But here's the great part. If you can connect, all the imperfections don't matter because it feels perfect. That's the goal, is we have to create this balance between being credible and being relatable. Now, I've screwed this up many times on both ends of the spectrum. When I was young, I realized I didn't have a lot of credibility. And as I went out and talked to people, they were usually older, they were usually wiser, they had more experience than me, and they just didn't see me as very credible. They would look at me and say, who is this guy? What's he gonna teach me? I was pretty relatable. They seemed to like having me around. They enjoyed the conversation, but they weren't buying my products. They weren't following my vision. They weren't doing anything with me. And so I figured out how to tell a story that lended me credibility. It would go like this. I would sit down with somebody who was older than me, usually had more experience, and I would have this conversation. First thing out of my mouth, I'd say, you know, I kind of feel like a young Bill Gates. And they'd kind of laugh, they'd smile, but that's what I wanted. I wanted engagement, right? And I'd say, here's what I mean. You know, Bill Gates was 19 when he dropped out of school, right? And at the time, I mean, if you remember, computers were huge. They were the size of refrigerators. They were super expensive. And Bill Gates said he was going to put a personal computer in every home in the world. People probably thought he was nuts. They were like, who's this young, naive entrepreneur? No idea what he's talking about. Now, here's the thing. I'm not saying that I'm going to be as rich as Bill Gates is. And I'm not saying I'm going to change the world the same way Bill Gates has. What I am saying is that I have something here that I am going to do great things with. And all I'm asking is for you to take a serious look at it. Is that fair? You willing to do that? That was the story that I told over and over and over. I don't know how many thousands of times, but it lended me credibility to where people would actually take me seriously. And it was interesting, as we started to have success, I lost relatability at times. I remember sitting down in front of people or speaking to people, and they would say something like, you know what, Ty, you're going to be amazing. I just don't see myself doing it. And what did I had created this disconnect where I wasn't relatable anymore. And it's really a balance. We have to find a balance between those two things. Now, I want to show you one of my favorite video clips. This clip comes from The Pursuit of Happiness. Great movie if you've never seen it. It stars Will Smith. Now, in this clip right here, Will Smith is going into an interview. And this is not a perfect situation. It doesn't go perfectly. But I want you to pay close attention to what Will Smith does to engage the audience, to be credible and relatable. We're going to talk about that right after this. So look at that. Was that perfect? Was it a perfect situation? No, it never goes perfect. But what did he do to make it work? What were things, specific things that he did that connected with the audience?
Humor.
Humor's fantastic. What does humor do? Humor causes people to let their guard down, just to open up, to be relatable. And I'm not saying you have to have like a knock-knock joke prepared. Just be normal. Just be relaxed and be able to be humorous in the way that you present to people. What else did he do?
He was authentic.
You just said he was honest. Is that like the most bizarre idea we've ever thought of? Like that we could actually be real with somebody, that we could actually talk about something that was true instead of trying to put ourselves in this perfect light that we're just amazing? That's where we make a connection, when we're authentic, when we're vulnerable, when we actually share the truth of what's happened. That's what's relatable, right? The credibility comes by overcoming the struggle, not because of the struggle. The relatability comes because of the struggle. What else did he do? Yeah, Barry. Okay. So sometimes we're put in a tough spot. Sometimes it's, you know, have you ever spoken to an audience that is dead? That you get up on stage and you know they are just as dead can be. The last thing they want to have is one more speaker. And yet you have to push through and figure out how to connect with them, right? That's a challenge that each of us are going to face at some point. Great thought. What else? Yeah.
In spite of the very awkward circumstances, he went forth with confidence and shook all their hands and he just went for it.
He did. He was very confident. And did you see the part where he literally put his hands up, he changed the tone of his voice, and he got really serious and said, look, this is what I'm all about, right? He changed their perception of him. In speaking, we call that variation, changing the tone, changing the approach in it. Because if I just speak to you in a monotone voice and I tell you how excited I am to be here, it's just not that entertaining and there's nothing engaging about my voice always staying like this, right? But if I can change, I can move, I can change the inflection in my voice, you can create an engagement and a connection with people. That's what we're trying to do. We're trying to create this balance. When we approach it, the mindset of an influencer is that you are focused on your audience. It's about them. It's never about you. Think about it. Your story is not about you. Your story is for them. It's about them, and we need to learn to make it about them. We need to engage them, because without engagement, there's no influence, and we need to create this balance of credibility and relatability. That's the mindset. Now let's talk about the skill set. Let's talk about how you craft an influential story. To do that, you need to understand how I look at a story. This is my definition. A story is a reimagined experience narrated with enough detail and feeling to cause your listener's imagination to experience it as real. Okay, so a story is a reimagined experience. It's narrated with enough detail and feeling to cause your listener's imagination to experience it as real. It's not about you, it's about them. And here's the foundation for influential storytelling. You don't retell a story, you relive a story. You don't retell a story, you relive a story. Because when they relive a story with you, when your audience feels it, that's where it becomes emotional. That's where it becomes engaging. That's where they start to take action. Now, scientifically, the way that this happens is in our minds, there are cells that are called mirror neurons. Mirror like a mirror that you look in neurons. And mirror neurons are amazing. They allow us as human beings to experience other people's feelings, their thoughts, and their emotions. Now, before that sounds too sci-fi, this is how somebody shows empathy and intuition when they're talking to you. We can place ourselves in other people's shoes. We can feel what they're feeling. And when people feel that you feel validated, don't you? Okay. What you can do as a storyteller is if we relive a story in a way that it activates the mirror neurons of the listener, what we're allowing them to do is to experience it as their own. Now, why is that influential? Because if they experience it, the aha moment of the story, the takeaway, the solution, the strategy that's being implemented because of that story, that they automatically adopt that as their own, and they start to implement it. It's not enough just to cause them to be emotional. It's emotional with a purpose. They start to move forward with it. And so we need to learn how to tell a story. No, we need to learn how to relive a story so that it activates their mirror neurons, so that they experience it. So how do we do that? Well, there's lots of ways we do that. The number one way is that we need to bring the audience into the story. We need to bring them in. We need to let them experience. We need to let them live it. So it's not just a story they're hearing, it's a story they're feeling. There's three specific techniques that I'll teach you on how you do that. These are three simple things. Place the audience in the scene, create curiosity, reinforce relatability. So here's what you do. Number one, you place them in the scene. This is done by simply adding a line into your story where you say something like, you know, Mitch, if you had been sitting in my office with me the first time I ever had an interview, I mean, it was nerve-wracking, right? What did I do? I physically placed him in the scene. If you had been standing there next to me as I was looking at the sunset, I mean, it was breathtaking. So I'm actually placing you there. So when you hear that, you're starting to visualize it all around you, right? That's placing them in the scene. All it is adding a simple line into your story, really simple concept. The second, creating curiosity. This is done typically on the front end of a story. And it's done by asking a you-focused question. A you-focused question means it has to have the word you in it. It's not about you, it's about them. So here's the truth. Not a single person in the entire world, including your mother, cares about your story. That's the truth. That's harsh, I understand that. They don't care about their story unless they know how it applies to them, right? If we know that there's something in it for us, then we actually care, we actually listen. So how do we create, pique a curiosity for them to say, yeah, I want to listen to this story because I feel like it could be about me? The way that you do that is you ask a you-focused question on the front end of the story. So you open them up with a question and you bring them into your world with a story. Think about all the stories that I've told you so far. I started with the Howard Schultz story. What was the you-focused question that I asked? How many of you recognize the name Howard Schultz, right? I started with that. When I told my story, I asked a question, how many of you have ever felt like you were failing? Is that not the worst in the world? I made a little connection. And all of a sudden, then you feel like you can come into my story because it pertains to you. When I talked about Stephen Covey, I started with his book, how many people have read The 7 Habits of Highly Effective People? It's a you-focused question. So you pique their curiosity on the front end so that then you can bring them into your story. And the beauty of it is then they feel like it's their story. Then they feel like it's all about them, and they're starting to relive it with you. Now, there's times throughout the story that you can create curiosity. You can ask questions. Again, you focus questions. When you're telling a story, there's sometimes that you'll step out of the story and say, what would you do in that situation? Right? And physically, if you're on a stage, I would step out of the story. We're not going to go into movement today, but I would step out of it and say, what would you do in that situation? Let them think about that, let them reflect, and then step back into it and finish your story. So you're creating curiosity because if they're curious, they're engaged. If they have a question in their mind that they want answered, they're going to continue to listen. Okay, the third is that you reinforce relatability. Reinforcing relatability is how you have this conversation. And again, you can have a conversation with a huge audience. Let me just ask you this question. Has this felt like a conversation or has it felt like I've just been talking at you? I am constantly saying things in the way that I speak where I say things like, do you know what I mean? Have you ever felt that before? I don't know if you've ever experienced something like this, but this is what happened. Do you know what that feels like? I'm constantly throwing it back on the audience. I'm reinforcing that relatability. I'm trying to be as conversational as I can because if I can throw it back on you, I'm reminding you, it's about you, it's about you, it's about you, it's not about me. This story's about you, and so you keep throwing it back on the audience. You develop this conversational tone in the way that you speak. And when you do that, you reinforce that relatability so that they stay connected, they stay engaged. Now, there's times that you can make that even more personal. I'll give you an example. One of my favorite stories to tell is the story of Mel Fisher. Mel Fisher is the greatest treasure hunter the world's ever known. He discovered a treasure called the Treasure of the Atocha, which is worth $400 million. Now, before you think that's my new career, he searched the ocean floor for 17 years to find that treasure. Okay, so this is an amazing story I tell to sales audiences. It's about persistence. It's about going after it. It's about staying with it to find your treasure. That's the tagline, right? At the end of that's how I relate it to them. Well, not too long ago, I was speaking to a group of network marketers. There are about 1,500 people in the audience. Now, you need to understand network marketers are they're entrepreneurs. They're unconventional. They're involved in an unconventional business. They think a little bit differently than most people think. And they kind of pride themselves on it. So knowing that about my audience, there's a point in the story where I said Mel and his wife Dio made a decision. They closed their shop, they picked up their family, they moved from California across the country to Florida and decided to search for treasure full time. Now most of the time when I share that, there's an audible gasp in the audience. Most people are like, what in the world? But I knew that my audience, they're unconventional, right? So I used that as a chance to reinforce relatability. So I said that line. I said, they moved to Florida to search for treasure full time. And then I said, you know, most people would think that's crazy, but all of you are in network marketing, so you're probably thinking, yeah, that makes a lot of sense. And I got this huge laugh because I related it to them, to the actual audience that I was speaking to. And all of a sudden, they felt like Mel Fisher's story was their story, because I'm reinforcing that relatability. These are three simple techniques that if you will start to apply these to your stories, these are little changes. They're not hard. You just place somebody in the scene. You say something like, if you had been there with me, if you were sitting there when this happened, or you start your story by asking a you-focused question. So people actually care about what you're gonna share and they feel like it's about them. And then throughout, you reinforce this relatability. These techniques are gonna bring the audience into the story so that they can relive it with you. When they start to relive it, let's talk about the structure of it. How do you put a story together? How do you craft it? Well, the starting point of any story is the call to action. What is the purpose? Why are you telling that story? It may be simply to get a laugh. That may be the purpose. It may be to sell a product. It may be to introduce a takeaway message. Whatever it is, you figure out what that purpose is. And then you use that purpose, that call to action, as the measuring stick against with everything that you put into the story, you measure it against. There's a rule in communication, in all storytelling, where the rule is this: if it's not necessary to say, then it's necessary not to say. We need to get rid of all of the extra fluff, all of the stuff that doesn't need to be there, because when we go off on these tangents and we give all these unnecessary details, we kill the engagement of the story. The more concise a story can be, the more compelling it can be. So you want to make sure that you cut down, trim the fat, get it to exactly what you want. Now, there's a blueprint for a story, just like this building we're in. There's a blueprint. There's a specific model that they followed to create this building so that it's solid. The blueprint for a story, the structure of an influential story, is three parts. There's the setup, the struggle, and the solution. The setup, the struggle, the solution. Okay, so in the setup, you provide context. You explain all the things that they need to know so that the story makes sense. You set the scene, you show where it's happening, and then you introduce the main characters. Those three things. You provide context, you set the scene, and you introduce the main characters. Then you introduce the struggle. Now, here's the key. There is something about struggle that just engages us emotionally. Conflict, struggle, the hard things that are happening to you. There's something about us as human beings that we are constantly, we're just totally hooked by that. So the struggle is the hook of your story. If you hook them with the struggle, then you can help them with the solution. If the struggle is relatable, then the solution will become credible. And so you want to get to the struggle as quickly as possible. So the setup, you want to do that as quick as you can so that you can throw them into the struggle so that you can engage them emotionally. Now, what kind of struggle am I talking about? Well, if you go back to like a creative writing class or something that you've taken before, there's five types of struggle. There's man versus man, right? Man versus man, this back and forth, this conflict. It's all relatable. We've all dealt with that before. Think about the movie Rocky. Okay, literally, Rocky's standing in a ring fighting Apollo Creed or the Russian or Mr. T or whoever it is. There's this conflict, this struggle where you're trying to overcome, and it's emotionally engaging. The second is man versus nature. Man versus nature, maybe a tornado, a snowstorm, whatever it may be. We've all had those experiences. That's another type of conflict. Think about the movie Twister. Right, these tornadoes are coming in and they're trying to, that's the struggle that they're dealing with throughout that movie. There's man versus society, trying to overcome the societal norms, trying to change what is the commonality, what is universally accepted. If you haven't seen it yet, I would highly recommend you go see the movie Lincoln. Amazing movie, I just saw it last weekend. It is about how Lincoln was fighting the societal norm of slavery. how he was pushing and fighting, the struggle that he had to overcome and create that emancipation that took place, right? Amazing struggle to solution story. There's man versus environment. You know, somebody who's in a tough situation, who's struggling in the environment that they're in. That movie we just showed, Pursuit of Happiness, is a man versus environment situation. Chris Gardner was in poverty. He was trying to break out of it. He's trying to create something new for himself. Perfect struggle to solution story. Go watch that movie. And then there's man versus himself. You know, if we would get real, if we would be honest, if we would be vulnerable, if we would be authentic, and we would share the struggles that we really deal with, those are some of the greatest stories that are ever told. Some of the best speakers you've ever heard in your life are the speakers who shared the truth of the struggles that they've overcome. You know, Chad Hymas isn't here with us today, but Chad, if you've ever heard Chad speak, one of the reasons he is such an amazing speaker is because he shares his struggle to solution, his struggle with himself, the things that he had to overcome, the things that he had to fight through. So you have this struggle that takes place, and what happens is the struggle hooks the audience. It brings them in. And you increase that struggle until the solution is introduced, and that solution is introduced by the hero of the story. Now, the hero of the story could be a product, could be an idea, could be a mentor, could be whoever. One thing I would caution you with, don't make yourself the hero of every story you tell. Number one, you're not that great. And number two, it's not relatable to the audience. Think about it. The things that you share most often, you learn from a mentor. You learn from somebody. Let them be the hero. It sounds better. You can connect with the person better. The hero of my story wasn't me. I made a change, but it was because of my wife. She's the one who gave me the courage, who gave me the line. She's the hero of the story, right? Let somebody else be the hero more often than not. It's more relatable. Okay, so think about it. We're using movies as an analogy. If we all went to a movie, we walk across to City Creek here. Do they have a movie theater? I don't know. But if you walk over to wherever a movie theater is, we go and we sit down, and we're excited for this movie, and we sit down, and we've got our popcorn in one hand, our drink in the other, and the movie starts in about this guy that just merrily skips through life. Everything's perfect. Everything turns out. Everything's roses. There's no ups. There's no downs. All of us would leave and go, that was the stupidest movie I've ever seen in my life. I mean, what was the point of that, right? There was no struggle. There was nothing to it, nothing that engaged anybody. Because in real life, there is struggle. And in real stories, there is struggle. And if you want to be influential, you have to have this model of struggle to solution. Now, it's not struggle for struggle's sake. We don't want to hear about how your life's horrible. We want to hear about how your life was horrible and how now it's incredible. That's where the solution comes in, right? It's taking someone from struggle to solution. Okay, so think about the movie Titanic. We all know that movie, right? There's a setup, there's context, they're on the boat, there's different levels, different stations of people, different classes and everything, and then boom, they hit the iceberg. They're thrown into a struggle, and the water level starts to come in, and it comes into their ankles. What if it stopped at their ankles? That would be kind of boring, like, oh, that's too bad, you got your feet wet, you know? I mean, I hope you're gonna be okay, right? It wouldn't be as engaging, but what happens is it comes into their ankles and then it goes to their knees, and then it raises to their waist, and then it raises to their chest, and pretty soon they have to all jump out of the boat. They're swimming, right? What you do is you introduce the struggle and then you incrementally increase it, just like you would the rising water level. Think about it that way. And you incrementally increase it, and it engages more and more. Emotionally, you're engaged with it until you reach the climax, and it's at the climax that the solution is introduced. That's how a story flows, right? It's the setup, the struggle, the solution. Now, I'll illustrate this with a story that has become kind of a signature story for me. Let me grab this real quick. So when I speak on the power of influence, I'm talking about winning with people. And I'm talking about, you know, how you create influence with people. And one of the stories I tell was an experience that happened to me. And there's a takeaway message to it, and this is how the story goes. So I don't know if you guys can relate to this, but there's sometimes that I feel like life would be just a whole lot better if you didn't have to deal with other people. Do you guys ever feel like that? So with what I do, I fly quite a bit. And because I'm based in Salt Lake City, Utah, I fly Delta exclusively. Well, I fly with them so often that I get upgraded to first class virtually every time I fly. So not too long ago, I had a speech up in the Bay Area. I was flying from Salt Lake to Oakland. Quick, painless hour and a half flight. I was upgraded to seat 4B, and I sat down. I think I was the first person on the plane. I sat down. I was pulling out my iPad. I wasn't paying attention as other people were coming on the plane. And all of a sudden, this gentleman stopped next to me, and he said, "Get up. You're in my seat." He said it just like that, too. He said, "Get up. You're in my seat." And I looked up, and I went, "Wow, I'm sorry. What seat are you in?" And he said, "This is first class. Do you realize this is first class? You're in my seat." Don't you love people like that? And I said, "Yes, I realize this is first class. I'm also seated in first class. What seat are you in?" And then he asked me what I still believe is the dumbest question I've ever heard in my entire life. He said, "Did you pay to sit in first class, or did you just get upgraded? Because I paid for my first class seat." And so I answered him. I said, "I got upgraded," which really stinks for you, because that means I paid a lot less money for the exact same seat. I said, "What seat are you in?" And he said, "4C." And I thought, you have got to be kidding me. I said, "4C is right there across the aisle. 4B, this is my seat." And without any hesitation, any apology or anything, he just turns and he sits down in a seat. And you know, I don't usually get worked up with people, but by this point I was ticked. So I turned and I looked at him. I said, "You know what? You would suck at what I do." And he goes, "What?" I said, "I didn't stutter. I said, you would suck at what I do." And he said, "Why is that?" I said, "Because you're not good with people. You're horrible with people." I said, "Just be nice. It's not that hard." And he looked at me like no one had ever told him he was a jerk before. I told that story last week, and the woman in the front row goes, "No, his ex-wife told him he was a jerk. I'm sure of it." Have you ever met the guy in 4C? I mean, we meet that guy everywhere, right? Okay, so that's the story. Okay, I tell that story to illustrate a point that we need to have good interactions with people. It's funny, it's entertaining, it really happened. Let's analyze it for a minute. There's a setup. I have to provide context. You need to know that I fly with Delta and I get upgraded for it to make sense, right? I set the scene, I'm seated in seat 4B, I'm not paying attention, and I introduce the main character. We'll call him the jerk in 4C. You know he's a jerk because of the tone in his voice. I throw us into the struggle from the minute he says hello. He doesn't say hello. He said, "Get up, you're in my seat." And you hear the tone in his voice. You know that. The struggle takes place. This is a man versus man struggle, right? He says something stupid. I respond. And every response, we keep incrementally increasing that struggle until I finally provide the solution and I just let him have it, right? So it follows that exact model. The setup, the struggle, the solution. Now, do you see how a story you start to craft it, and it starts to take place, and you start to see there's just specific components to it. Now, when you understand the structure, you understand the science of storytelling. But here's the key. To be a master storyteller, you need to master the art of storytelling. And the art I can't give you. The art you have to give yourself. The only way you can master it is if you tell stories. The only way you can be a great speaker is if you speak. Now, I had an interesting experience. When I was 19, I served a 2-year mission for my church. I went to Portugal, and for 2 years, I was out teaching people. I had to learn Portuguese and teach in another language, which is a feat in and of itself, but the whole time I was there, we're in Utah, so you've probably seen Mormon missionaries before, I was with a companion. Right? So I had a companion that was with me everywhere I went. And every single day for 2 years, we had an hour-long companionship study in the morning. And what we would do is we would open up this book that taught us a concept on how to teach, how to share our message more effectively. And we would study that for 15 minutes. And then for 45 minutes, we would role play that back and forth. Now, I can tell you that two 19-year-old guys, the first time you do this, it is awkward. It is just weird. It's like embarrassing. I mean, you're embarrassed and nobody's around to be embarrassed from. It's just awkward. But as I kept doing it over and over again, pretty soon it became natural. And after doing it every single day for 2 years, it became second nature. And if you want to be a great storyteller, you need to practice. Role play it. Do it over and over again. Share it with family, friends, whoever, in the mirror. Just practice it over and over and over again. Develop that habit of role-playing. Not only that, but you should record yourself. You should videotape yourself. You should go back and analyze it. Because if you want to be a great storyteller, you have to practice it. It's like a skill set, any other skill set in the world. You can master the art of storytelling if you work at it. I'll give you the tools, but I can't make you better. I can give you ideas and structure and how you could put it together, but only you can make yourself better. Now, there's kind of a debate between speakers who some speakers would say you should memorize your stories. And some would say, no, you should just kind of tell it off the cusp because it's more natural, it's more authentic. I'll give you my two cents on it. I think that you should memorize your stories until you have them down so well that it's so natural that it feels like you're telling them for the very first time. That 4C story that I just told you, did it feel like it was authentic, it was real, it was genuine? Did you connect with it? You laughed, right? I don't know how many times I've told that story this year, but it's a lot. Thousands. I tell that story all the time. But I tell it in a way that it feels like it's the first time. Remember, in our mindset, it's about the audience. And so it needs to feel like it's the first time for them. And if you can learn it in a way to where you tell it and it feels so natural, the audience is just engaged, it feels like they're hearing new information for the very first time, there's something amazing about that. How many of you have ever heard of Peter Vidmar? Olympic gold medalist, he's a Hall of Fame speaker, he's a great friend of mine. He and I have shared the stage multiple times. I've heard his story. I know his story. I've heard him tell his story over and over again. You can't tell me he hasn't memorized that story. He tells it the same way every single time. I could tell you his story the same way every single time. I've heard it enough. His pauses are the same. He laughs at the same parts. He moves the same way. But there's something amazing about it every time he tells it. It still connects. He has this enthusiasm, this excitement. He uses those same tools that we've been talking about. His audience is engaged. They buy into it. They feel it. They relive it. And every time he connects with his audience, because he's telling it to them like it's their very first time. Now, I would also really encourage you to record yourself, both audio and video. Go back and listen to it. It's frightening. It really is. The first time you're like, I didn't even know my voice sounded like that. Seriously? It sounds so much deeper and fuller in my head, you know? I mean, it's amazing how that comes across. Then you videotape yourself, and you're like, what am I doing? I mean, let's work on some, I mean, so when you videotape yourself, here's a couple ideas. Videotape yourself on a stage. Go back and watch it and fast forward. If you're going like this the whole time and fast forward, you're a pacer. Stop it. That's annoying. The audience is like, why is he moving so much? Just calm down and just find a spot. Then watch it in mute. Look at your facial expressions. Look at your gestures and go, is that adding to the story? Is that actually sharing something? Is it distracting? Is it weird? Then go take it piece by piece and go, okay, what was the purpose of my opening? Did I actually connect? And start to analyze it. You see, the people who do this are the people who want to be professionals. And I would assume everybody in here wants to be a professional. You want to be a master storyteller. Now, we've talked about the mindset. We've talked about the skill set. You understand the structure, how you put a story together. Let's talk about the tool set real quick. Let's see here. There we go. Okay, so the tool set is a bunch of tools that you can use at different times that make your stories come alive. Now, it's just like your tools at home. If you have a toolbox, there's times that you're going to use all of them, and there's times that you're only going to use one or two of them. You know, sometimes you need a hammer. Sometimes you need a hammer and a screwdriver. Sometimes you need everything. And it's kind of comical that I'm sharing that analogy because I'm the least handy person in the entire world. I can't even hang a picture. Okay, but the tool set works just like that. So there's six tools. The two C's that make stories compelling are curiosity and characters. The two D's that make stories dynamic are dialogue and details. The two M's that make stories memorable are movement and metaphors. Now, I don't have time to go into all of these with you today, but the two that I think would help the very most for speakers are dialogue and details. So I want to dive into those. Dialogue and details. They make your stories dynamic. They make them multi-dimensional. They make your stories come alive so that your audience can relive your story with you. Now, dialogue is an amazing tool. Dialogue is one of those tools that I think really separates good speakers, good storytellers from great storytellers, is when you know how to use the appropriate amount of dialogue in your story. Dialogue does a lot of amazing things. Number one, it sets the story in present tense. It automatically puts somebody in the scene. They start to relive it with you. It activates the mirror neurons of the listener because they're hearing it take place. It also is the number one place to uncover humor and to add impact into a story. is to do it through dialogue. Now, there's a balance between narration and dialogue because every story needs both. Narration is used to provide context, to explain everything that's happening and to bring it all together. But dialogue is used for the impact lines. If there's ever an emotionally charged line, if there's ever a funny line, if there's ever, you know, when your mentor teaches you the takeaway point, tell it in dialogue. Let them deliver the line, because what it does is it allows the character to be heard so you can connect with that character. It allows the line to have much more impact. Think about it. If I was telling a story where, if I did it in narration, what if I said, you know, my friend Susan called me the other day and said she had cancer. That could be emotionally impactful, but what if I did it in dialogue? What if I said, you know, my friend Susan called me and she said, Ty, I have cancer. I don't know what to do. Do you see a difference between those two, right? Just simply letting her say the line changes it. Mark Twain had a great quote. He said, don't tell me that the lady screamed. Bring her on stage and let her scream. Let them deliver the lines, because it connects you with the character. It teaches you about them. Let them show exactly what it is that they're trying to say. Now, there's not a science to it. I can't say that it's 25% dialogue and 75% narration. It's an art. You have to find that balance. It's not a specific equation. But on one side, narration kind of feels like a report. It's like an outsider looking in, right? And there's nothing engaging about that. On the other side, if you go too far in telling a story in dialogue, it's too theatrical. It just feels awkward. It feels weird. So somewhere between theatrics and a report, there's a middle ground that creates a perfect story. You have to find that in the way that you craft your story, in the way that you role play your story, in the way that you break it down so that you understand how to create it. Now, you think about the 4C story that I tell. I use narration to set the scene and explain who's talking to who and what's happening. But all of the lines, they're all in dialogue. There's a back and forth. He says his line, I say my line. There's a back and forth in that. So when it pertains to dialogue, there's three places that you can use it. Let's see here. Not that one. There we go. There's an acronym for this. It's CIA, like the government agency. CIA, this is how you use dialogue. First is character dialogue. This is the most obvious natural place for dialogue to take place. Character dialogue is where you let your characters deliver their lines. Where I let the jerk in 4C say the lines and make him sound like a jerk. Where I respond and say my own lines to him. Right? Character dialogue is that back and forth. It's that exchange. Now, sometimes you're going to tell a story where there's no exchange, there's no back and forth, but you can still allow the character to tell their line. Think about the Howard Schultz story that I told. Most of that story was told in narration, but when he left Starbucks that day, I said his line in dialogue because I wanted you to get an understanding of his conviction. He said, I'm going to be part of that company, right? I let him say the line. So you want to let your characters deliver their lines as much as possible. When I said his finishing line, we're not in the coffee business serving people. We're in the people business serving coffee. I let him say the line. It's his line, right? So I say it in dialogue. The second is inner dialogue. Now, inner dialogue is where you take a thought process and you express it outwardly as a line in your story. Now, some people may say this is a stretch. I think if you say it inside, it's the same as saying it outside. But there's times that it will provide context, like in the 4C story. When the guy finally tells me what seat he's in, I didn't audibly say, you've got to be kidding me. I thought it. I was biting my tongue to not say it, right? But I say, and when I tell the story, I said, I thought, you have got to be kidding me. I want you to understand what frame of mind I'm in. So I'm taking my inner dialogue and I'm expressing it outwardly. So we can do that sometimes. Honestly, with the Howard Schultz story, I don't know that he ever said, I'm going to be part of that company. I've never met him. I've studied him. I know that was his design, and so it was at least a thought process, so I took a liberty and I let him say the line because there's more impact in that. Okay, the third is audience dialogue, and this is kind of a risk. This is an advanced technique, but if you think about it, audience dialogue is where you take the thought process of your audience and you put it into dialogue. Maybe you're sharing some crazy story and you look at me and go, Elaine's looking at me like, wow, you're nuts. Like, I take her thought process and I put it into a line. I almost put the words into her mouth, right? So there's a risk in that. But guess what happens? If you can make that work, you can add huge amounts of humor and you can ultimately connect with your audience. That's what I did in that Mel Fisher example that I gave you, where I did that for network marketers. I said, all of you must be thinking, well, we're in network marketing, so you're probably thinking, yeah, that makes a lot of sense. So I took their thought process and I put it into a line. If you can do that, if ultimately the goal is to create connection with your audience, if you can take that risk and put audience thought processes into dialogue, it can be a great connection piece with your audience. So when it pertains to dialogue, there's three places that you use it. Character dialogue, inner dialogue, audience dialogue. Now the caution is this. If you've never used dialogue before, you jump way over here to theatrics and it sounds so awkward and so weird, right? You have to find that balance of it. Remember what the purpose is. Narration is to provide context, to help bring everything together. Dialogue should be implemented when there's a humor line, an emotionally charged line, an impact line. That's where you use it, okay? That's dialogue. That's the first D that makes stories dynamic. The second D is details. Now, some of you go, all right, you said to if it's not necessary to say, it's necessary not to say, so wouldn't that eliminate most of the details? Well, it eliminates the unnecessary details. But there are places where details are really important, because what do details do? Details create images. We think in images, right? A story is supposed to create images. Details make it vivid. They make it tangible. We want to have as many of the important details in a story as possible. Because when we can do that, we bring the story to life. Annette Simmons, who wrote the book The Story Factor, said this. She said, the counterintuitive secret of effective stories is that the more specific the story, the more universal the connections. The more specific the story, the more specific those details are, the more universally it connects to people. So where do you use details and where do you leave them out? Well, there's some specific places that you should use details. Three, to be exact. Anytime you have a location, an amount, or a time. Anytime you're using a location, amount, or a time, you want to use details. Okay, so let's look at a location. Don't say, I went to lunch with him today. Say, you know what, we went to lunch at the Cheesecake Factory. It was awesome. We had a great meal, right? Just that little detail just makes it a little bit more vivid. Because if you've been to the Cheesecake Factory, you start to picture it. Instead of saying, I checked into the hotel, say something like, have you ever been to Las Vegas? This is my first time. I checked into Caesar's Palace right on the Strip. They put me in room 842. I'm looking out, and there were like thousands of people out on the Strip. Now think about, is that more relatable? Do you connect with that better? Now think about this. When I use numbers, the room 842, what do you picture in your mind? What comes to mind? Do you picture the door with the number right on it, right? I've created an image. Most people would naturally picture that. And I want you to start to relive it with me. So you're starting to see it. You're walking in there. You're starting to look out. You're seeing the thousands of people. If you've ever been to the Strip before, you start to remember your own experience. So you're reliving the story. So when it comes to location, use details. When it comes to amounts, use details. Think about weight loss products. If you were selling a weight loss product and you said, you know, I've lost a lot of weight, really doesn't do that much for you. But if you ever looked at weight loss testimonials, they are very specific in amounts. They say something like, I've lost 20 pounds in 20 days, right? They're specific in that because the more specific they are, the more universally it connects. Same thing with time. If you're giving a specific time, a date, something like that, if you give a date, people start to remember where they were when that date took place. They start to connect with it. So I reference the Mel Fisher story. And I want to tell you that story because I want you to analyze the details that go into it and how it changes that story. Imagine as I'm sharing this, if I didn't put the details into it. So have you ever felt like you wanted to give up on your goal? Have you ever, there's times that just is hard, right? You don't know if you can keep going. And anytime I feel like that, I am really encouraged by one of my heroes, a guy named Mel Fisher. Mel Fisher was the greatest treasure hunter the world has ever known. Mel Fisher was born in Hobart, Indiana in 1922. And after World War II, he moved to California and he bought a chicken farm. And it was there in California that Mel discovered the two loves of his life, his wife Dolores, who we call Dio, and diving. He loved diving in the ocean. It was amazing for him. Well, in 1953, Mel and Dio were married. They sold the chicken farm, they moved to Redondo Beach, and they opened up the state's first dive shop. It was called Mel's Aqua Shop. It really wasn't much, but it was the only place in the state of California where divers could come and get equipment. And determined to grow their little business, they started to offer free dive lessons to anybody who came and bought equipment. They made modifications to existing snorkel gear and scuba gear, actually some of them we still use today. And they were some of the first people to make underwater movies, showing people the glories of the ocean. At one point, Dio decided to gain publicity for the shop. She actually challenged the current woman's record of staying underwater for 50 hours. So on August 2nd, 1959, she descended into this empty porpoise tank at the Hermosa Beach Aquarium. And with film crews and onlookers watching, she stayed underwater for 55 hours, 37 minutes, and 11 seconds. I mean, to pass the time, Mel set up a TV outside of the porpoise tank. He dove in one time and they started playing checkers. She read soggy books and magazines underwater. She set a world record. Well, they continued to grow their business. And at that point, Mel started diving on shipwrecks. And he found this passion in treasure hunting. Well, not long after that, they heard about this fleet, the 1715 fleet that supposedly carried this great treasure. It sunk off the coast of Florida, and so Mel and Dio made a decision. They closed their aqua shop, they picked up their family, they moved from California across the country to Florida and decided to search for treasure full time. Now, most people would think that's nuts, but all of you want to be professional speakers, so you're probably thinking, yeah, that makes a lot of sense, right? Not long into their search, they uncovered an entire carpet of gold coins on the seabed, one of many breathtaking discoveries by the fishers. Well, by 1968, they discovered most of the 1715 fleet, and so they were looking for more treasure to find. And it was then that a friend gave Mel a copy of the Potter, the Treasure Diver's Guide, in which the Nuestra Señora de la Atocha was described as one of the greatest treasures that had ever been lost. According to the guide, it was lost off the coast of the Florida Keys, and so for Mel, the search was on. They went and they started searching. They searched the ocean floor every single day for 3 years without finding a thing. And then finally, one of his divers found an 8.5-foot gold chain. It kept him going. But it wasn't for 2 more years until Mel's son, Dirk, found one single silver bar. But it had numbers inscribed on it that matched the Spanish manifest of the Atocha, so they knew it existed. 2 years after that, Mel's son Kane discovered 5 bronze cannons from the Atocha, and they thought, it's got to be close. They thought they were within days of finding the mother lode. But a week later, tragedy struck. One of their boats, the Northwind, capsized during the night, and Mel's son Dirk, Dirk's wife Angel, and another diver, Rick Gage, were all killed. All in all, the hunt for the Atocha claimed 4 young lives. But Mel kept searching. He knew his treasure existed. He just kept going after it. His persistence was almost unhuman. He searched the ocean floor every single day for more than a decade. He endured the loss of his son, his daughter-in-law, and 2 of his other divers. He constantly had to go and convince investors to fund them so that they could continue their search. And he had this amazing saying. Every single day as he came up out of his cabin on the boat, he would say, today is the day. Today is the day. I know we're going to find it. Every single day. Well, his persistence and his optimism paid off because on July 20th, 1985, a magnometer indicated something down on the seabed. And they dove down to see what it was, and they found they were sitting on an entire reef of silver bars. They found it. They found the mother lode, the Atocha. All of Key West came out to see what he had found. Mel, even Warren, or Jimmy Buffett himself actually came and he sat down on top of the pile of treasure. All in all, the treasure of the Atocha was 127,000 silver coins. It was 900 silver bars that weighed 70 pounds apiece. It was 900 emeralds, 2,500 other gems, 350 pounds of gold discs, bits, and lengths of gold chain. Estimates put the wreck's value at over $400 million. He had done it. He kept searching and he found his treasure. Okay, so that's the story, right? If I didn't add those details, would that be at all captivating? Think about it. When I talk about time, what was Dio's record? 55 hours, 37 minutes, and 11 seconds. It's something tangible. You give that. When I gave dates, July 20th, 1985 is when they actually discovered it. What does that make you think of? Maybe you think about where you were on July 20th, 1985. I was four. I don't remember where I was on July 20th, 19. But that's not the point, right? When you think about amounts, when I say 70-pound bars and I'm holding them like this, you can start to see it. What if I told you, Mel found the treasure of the Atocha. It was huge, big treasure. That's great. It's a really big treasure, right? But if I describe it, 127,000 silver coins, 900 silver bars, right? You can start to picture it because of those details. When I give you locations, all of the places that they went, she went to the Hermosa Beach Aquarium, it was at Redondo Beach, all of those things that they lived, I'm giving you specific details. Details make your stories dynamic. They make them come alive. Okay, now what time is it, 4:35? Okay, here's what we're gonna do. We've gone through the mindset, we've gone through the skill set, and we've gone through two of the tools, dialogue and details. I want you to grab a partner. There was an email that went out, and all of you were supposed to bring a 3-minute story. Ideally, you have a story in mind. If not, think of a story really fast. Okay, so here's what we're gonna do. You're gonna grab a partner, and I want you to practice that, telling that story to your partner. So one of you is gonna be partner A. Partner A is gonna tell the story. Partner B is gonna simply listen. Here's what I want. At the end of it, all I want partner B to do is I want you to give positive feedback. That's it. No negative feedback, just positive. What worked? What did they do to engage you? Did they balance credibility and relatability well? Did they use dialogue well? Was there a point where they added details that made it more dynamic? Was their struggle to solution captivating? Did they provide enough narration to make it all make sense, right? Give specific, tangible, positive feedback. So partner A is gonna go first. You have 3 minutes. Go.